Hello everybody, welcome to Sunday service.
Hi, good morning everyone.
Today is December 4th, 2016.
Let's us sing a song, holy song. Page 47, Angel we have heard on high, 47.
Angels we have heard on high.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in his light echo back their joyous strains.
Take me through the doorway, lead me
journey, and you hear it call. There's a path that you can find if you believe it's there. Follow it with all your heart, there's joy for all to share.
Life is pure, the world is near, the sun begins to rise. Love is here, and we are free to speak good children's eyes. So the truth shall make us free. Why walk when we can fly? On the wings of God's true love, higher than the sky. Fear and doubt shall pass away, His heart no longer cries. As we can children's eyes. So the truth shall make us free. Why walk when we can fly? On the wings of God's true love, higher than the sky. Here we learn to live for all, choosing to be wise. Measure not the things you give, just see through children's eyes. Though the truth shall make us free, why walk when we can fly? On the wings of God's true love, higher than the sky. If you choose to live this way, joy will fill your lives. We will give our best so all can see through children's eyes. So the truth shall make us free. Why walk when we can fly? On the wings of God's true love, higher than the sky.
Thank you. Let us stand up, greet every parent and children. Today is a Sunday morning. Let us bow to every parent and true parent. The Kyombed. Hello. Join me in prayer. Most lovely, every parent, God, true parents. We are so grateful to receiving new month and new week, every parent, that we can see the change of the air, every parent. Last month was America most incredible election. We can see that the all excitement and also the also horrible things what happened every parent in the past. Now that the America, the new president, the Obama to Trump, President Trump, every parent, we really want to that our nation can unite centering you, every parents, and with the Christ, the direction, every parents. We have to build that our kingdom of heaven in our hand, every parents. That we have a responsibility. Parents give guidance to the children. If we don't respond to the direction, we can never make it, every parents. We know that, every parents, we have to create our own hand to work hard to become the your son, daughter, to love you and receive your love and give our love to you, every parents. Through the relationship, we can learn many things. You are the wise God, loving God, and also that you have a judgment to the good and the evil. We have to learn what is good, what is bad or evil. We have a responsibility and freedom. We have to choose good, heavenly parents, because you are always loving us and taking care of us. And if we make mistake, you have to take our own to the change, heavenly parents. Now the time that America and the American people, American citizens, take responsibility to change, to be good nation. The past year was so many trouble, every parent, to terrorism and many ways that the fight was, we can see through media. And also the world, every parents. It's not necessary to fight and killing each other. We have to understand we are the your children. The any nation is come from you, heavenly parents. We have to know that we are the one that your children. That's why we have to know that our responsibility. Please guide this week. We can think about the what is our responsibility and what is what do we need to do to make your kingdom? Please guide this sermon can give the life to us and the direction and the guidance from heaven. We ask you that the heavenly guidance through our pastor. Thank you very much. We are exciting the new week and to make a good experience with you and to give a message to the other and make inspire the, our life. Please guide this time. Thank you very much. The report in the name of Raman Tamiko Montanaro, Central Blessed Family, Aju.
Amen.
Thank you. Please take it. Welcome our pastor.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
So today is Sunday. It's December the 4th. And our title today is A Self-Evident Nation. Ooh. Okay, A Self-Evident Nation. Those who know me know that I have a website, and we're going to be building the website name to Self-Evident Nation soon, which will take the website that I already have and just transfer it under this title, but it will have the same content and build on that. I've come to the realization over many, we've been doing this now for 4 years in our home. 4 years we've been giving sermon in our own home, and it's wonderful, but it's not enough. It's not enough to worry about people's spiritual life. That may seem stupid to say, because actually, if someone's spiritual life is strong, everything else takes care of itself. And that's true. So in one way, the spiritual life is the most important, right? How you feel every day. When you wake up in the morning, what do you want to give to the world? What are you hoping for? Where are you spiritually? You know, we never know what's going on in somebody's heart and mind, right? We never know how someone's feeling. So many times we think everything's fine, and then somebody, you know, does something very stupid, right, to themselves. We know that people's spiritual life is more important than anything else. How they feel about themselves, how they feel about God, how they feel about other people. So that's what our sermons focus on. And that's where, generally speaking, we have focused for the last 4 years, is to be helping people develop their spiritual life, right? But that's not enough. Because once you have a spiritual life, you have to engage with other people. You have to talk. You have to, even just with one person, you have to make a marriage and a family. You know, to love one person, to receive that person's love. Then that love creates children and family. And suddenly you have a whole bunch of other problems. You know, your children have to go to a hospital, right? Even the birth often is in the hospital, although some people are doing home births now. But still, the idea of doctors and friends and other families becomes really important. You know, no woman wants to give birth alone. In the pioneer days of America, many women did give birth alone. And many women did die actually giving birth, because there can be complications. You know, breech birth, where the baby is actually not coming out head first, but feet first. Or other kinds of complications. So women have died giving birth. It's scary, you know, to give birth. And it's much nicer if you can have other families around, a midwife at least, someone, an older woman usually, who's helped give birth many, many times. And that's important. But nowadays in modern society, we go to the hospital, and nurses and doctors are trained, and they have all the medical equipment in case there's an emergency. But not just that, but what about when the kids grow older? You want to educate them. Schools become important, right? So once you have a family, then you start talking about community. You start talking about, you know, parks and recreation. You want a place that kids can play, and that, you know, everyone can be healthy and fit. You want to talk about, that's public land then. So then you all have to contribute to that. Everyone who lives in the community should contribute. That's where taxes come in. Someone who has to administer those taxes, that's where the government comes in. You need a government to levy taxes, collect the taxes, hopefully in a righteous and not a corrupt way. But many, many, many governments in the United States and around the world are corrupt. They have public money coming in, and the temptation is very strong to misuse public money. The temptation is very strong when no one's watching you, to somehow, it's called embezzlement. Embezzlement, okay? When you filter money out of the public fund and put it in your own purse, in your own pocket, in your own bank account. And then suddenly, you know, somebody that everyone respected for 30 years disappears. And they find out that he's been embezzling funds for 30 years. He's been taking money and putting it away in an offshore bank account or something, and now he's gone to live in the Bahamas or something, and he's got millions of dollars, which he stole from the public. And it destroys public trust in government, and people don't trust their government anymore because they've seen too many examples of this. Here in Connecticut, our governor was thrown in jail, for Governor Rowland, I think, for not embezzlement exactly, but what he did was he took large amounts of money from friends who later on he paid back with contracts, government contracts, lucrative government contracts. So like the roads or some kind of maybe tree clearing things or whatever it might be that the government has to pay for, building new roads or fixing bridges or cutting down the trees that are in public areas or all the work that has to be done in a town. Well, those are done by people who get paid by the government. So he was giving those contracts out to his friends, people who had given him money during his campaign. So he was, that's called graft and corruption, I guess. And it's illegal. And the same thing happened actually to the governor of New Jersey and the governor of New York. So, I mean, we're sitting in the middle of a triangle of states that don't have a very good track record of government, you know, government trustworthiness. But we hope that if people do have a good spiritual life, if everyone that we elect to power has a good spiritual life, we can trust them. So when we elect people, we hope, we look at them and we hope this is a good person. More than all the promises they make about their different plans and economic plans and things, we look at the person. Is this person trustworthy? Can I trust them with my money? They're going to be holding my money. They're going to be controlling my money. So the importance of public trust is very, very, it's very important, that question, the question of public trust. Okay, so then we have schools and parks and recreation. The schools have to hire teachers. About 75 to 80% of every town budget in Connecticut and around the country is spent on education. It's the single biggest expense that any town or city has to pay. And 90% of that is salaries, teachers' salaries. So essentially, everyone in the town is pooling their money together by paying taxes, putting it together in the hands of the government, and the government is usually having a school board, right? You're electing a school board. Usually you vote for maybe 7 or 8, 10 people to be on the school board, which is a group of men and women who make decisions about education in that town. And they hire a superintendent, and the superintendent then is responsible for hiring principals at different schools and for hiring, you know, for supervising the whole education system directly. So the superintendent every day is doing that. The school board makes big decisions, like how much money is going to get spent, or what areas will get the money, which departments, which schools. Are they going to have are they going to fix this building that's getting old? Are they going to fix the roof? Are they going to put a new ball field in? Are they going to, you know, build a new school maybe, or hire 5 new teachers or something? So those decisions often are made by the school board. The superintendent supervises the daily managing of the school system. And then principals handle the buildings. In some big districts, like Bridgeport, we have 3 high schools, Harding, Central, and Bassett. I don't know how many middle schools there are and how many elementary schools, but it's probably close to 15 or 20 elementary schools all throughout the district, and maybe 5 or 6 middle schools, something like that. So, you know, it's a big district. So the superintendent can't be watching everything. So the building principals are responsible for watching every building. And they have vice principals and assistant deans, and then they hire staff, the teachers, and the staff. It's a big expense. Running a school is a huge expense. Millions of dollar budget. Millions of dollars get spent in every little town on the school system, on the budgets, especially for the salaries of teachers, of the administrators, of the principals, of the superintendent, everything. That's a big expense that tax money goes toward. But then, you also have other things the government has got to be interested in. My point is this, that, yes, at first, your spiritual life is the most important. It's the root. It's the beginning of everything. But once you make a family, and once children come, and you're raising babies, you need hospitals, you need parks and recreation, you need schools, you need a government to administer everything. And then, you want a place that you can be together with people, and pray, and connect, so you need churches, and you need to make other maybe community events or lodges, you know, like the Italian American Lodge or this other lodge. So there's different lodges and groups and clubs and different things people get together. We're not alone. We live in this world with other people, and everyone's our family. We all go back to Adam and Eve. We all share the same sin from Adam and Eve. And we've gone through the same histories, although some of them have been different, you know. And many times they fought. We have wars. I might have fought against your ancestors. my ancestors fought against your ancestors, right? So there's enemy relationships too. They have to be worked out. That's what we're working on now. But ultimately, we get to the national level, and nations have their own history, their own direction, their own hopes, their own dreams. And nations have, it's almost like a person. A nation is like a person. Like France is a person, England is a person, Germany is a person, the United States is a person, Japan is a person. You know, we all gravitate like 300 million people in this country are like 350 million cells in the body. We're all part of one body. We pay federal taxes for things the federal government does that the states and the cities can't do. The federal government is responsible for having an army, right, and defending the country's borders, right? The federal government has many responsibilities. Our country is one of the oldest countries in the world. People don't realize that. They think America is a young country because they think of America as being born in 1776. And if you look at Japan, the history goes back thousands of years. If you look at Korea, 4,300 years, right? If you go back, Israel goes back 6,000 years according to their own stories. If you look at, you know, Germany, you can go back to, you can trace the ancestors back at least 2,000 years in most places. America, the Native Americans were here in tribes scattered throughout the United States, and traveling mostly nomadic more than anything. They didn't really have towns like the European settlers did. They traveled usually wherever it was warmer maybe sometimes or colder, or they would travel. So there were these tribes, and then the settlers came in from Europe. And they began to pioneer and settle this country, and pushing the Indians out, actually. The speech we're going to read today is from God's Will in the World, which is kind of worn out. You can't see the title. God's Will in the World, which is a collection of Father's speeches, Reverend Moon's speeches. He gave these speeches throughout 30 years between... The first one that's written here is 1969. Actually, no, it's only like 14 years. And then the last one, I think, is 1984. So 15 years of speeches. Of course, Father continued to speak volumes and volumes of speeches after this, from 1984 all the way till his death in 2012. And before this as well, before 1969, volumes of speeches that he gave mostly in Korea and some in Japan. So this is just and this is not all the speeches he gave in those 15 years. This is just, Father was in prison in Danbury Federal Penitentiary in Connecticut for federal income tax evasion, which he was innocent of. He was merely the co-signer on the public church account, but the government chose to use that to attack him. They said he owned that money. That was his own personal money, which it wasn't. The Catholic Church does the same thing, where the bishop signs the checks, and the money is in his account and under his own name. Small storefront churches throughout America do the same thing. The pastor has the money of the church in a bank account in his own name, and the government understands that money's in trust, that person's not the owner of that money. So that money gains interest by sitting in the bank. That interest income is not considered private income. But the government chose to take the money that Father had called for, money from all over the world. Our missionaries all around the world, especially in Japan, had given millions of dollars to help Father do these crusades, these tours and speaking tours around America. He was not using the money for himself. He was using it for speaking tours. And the money for 3 years before the Unification Church was founded as a legal entity, the money was in the name of Father, Reverend Sunmin Moon, and Reverend Kamayama, Takeru Kamayama, who's a Japanese leader. So these two men, Father and Reverend Kamayama, signed the checks that were spent for 3 years. The money wasn't theirs, though, and clearly, even in the court case, it came out that everything was spent for public purpose. But the government, because Father was so unpopular in the late 1970s, early 1980s, he was so unpopular, everyone hated him so much, that they said, yeah, but the whole church is your church anyway, you own it. So whatever you do is just for yourself. That money was your personal money. And then, as a result, the interest that money gained for 3 years. They said that was personal income, and you didn't declare it. You didn't report your income to the government, and you didn't pay taxes on that income. The total amount was about $7,000. No one in America, if they're found guilty of tax evasion for $7,000, would be put in jail. You pay the $7,000 plus a fine, and that's it. They put Father in jail for 1 year and a half. They sentenced him to 1.5 years, of which he served 13 months. They actually didn't want to put him in jail. What they were hoping was, when the verdict came out, he was in Korea at the time, they were hoping he wouldn't come back. Good riddance. Goodbye, Reverend Moon. We got rid of Reverend Moon. But instead, he came back and went to jail. He said, I'm innocent, so I'm going to go to jail. And during that time, thousands of Christian ministers around America began studying Reverend Moon's teaching. It was a miracle. All these Christian ministers who had opposed Reverend Moon began to change. And they began to study Father's teaching and Father's words and began to like what he was saying. And then when he came out, 1.5 years later, they had a banquet in Washington, D.C. in his honor that was hosted by the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, which was Martin Luther King's old group, led by Reverend Joseph Lowery, who actually was the minister who gave the convocation at Obama's inauguration. That's how important of a man supported Reverend Moon when he came out of prison. And Jerry Falwell, Reverend Jerry Falwell, who was the leader of the Moral Majority, which is a white Christian conference of very conservative Christians, very much the opposite politically of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, and everyone in between. There were white and black and Hispanic and Asian ministers there, and everyone, 1,800 Christian ministers, welcomed Father as a hero of religious liberty in America. And it began an amazing period in the late 80s when many, many Christian ministers began to study divine principle and study about Father's life and actually became members of Father's movement and became aware that Father was a good man. So Father's suffering in prison, and he told us this. He said, God will raise up from this something great. He's been to prison many times, and he knows that when you are unjustly, unrighteously persecuted, God will use that to claim a victory. In prison, he read every day dozens of his speeches from the last 30 years of his life. He read them, he had them all brought in, and he was reading them. And he chose the ones that he felt were most iconic or most important. And he included them in a volume called God's Will in the World, which he had sent to all these Christian ministers. And our members, I remember doing this, we had little boxes with a copy of this and a videotape. I forgot what was on the videotape, maybe a picture of Father speaking at Washington Monument and Madison Square Garden, something like that. And a few other books, or different things. And we brought these boxes to thousands of Christian ministers around America. Father wanted to make a gift like this. So he's in prison, and also when he was in prison, he founded the Washington Times. During the time of his trial and imprisonment, the Washington Times was being founded to protect America, because America was under siege at that time. It was being attacked by Marxist activists, and what's that? Yeah, they were coming in. They were here in America, and they were pushing to change America's future and to kick America out of any involvement in the world, so that communism could take over. So it was a very serious time. Reagan was president, and Father founded the Washington Times, which Reagan said he read every day. It supported Reagan to understand what was right and wrong during his presidency. And it led to the collapse of the Berlin Wall in 1989. The Washington Times led to Gorbachev declaring the Soviet Union to be no longer communist, basically. Glasnost and perestroika, the two words for opening and for liberty, freedom, and opening of the Soviet Union. So the Washington Times was very important in American history. It changed American history. And Father spent millions of dollars pouring in to Washington Times while he had been imprisoned by the United States government. So this is the book we're reading from. And I recommend, I'll include the link for it online. And I recommend, if you've never read this book, that you pick it up and you go take your time and read it one speech at a time. There are about 30 or 40 speeches in here, and they're all wonderful. and you'll learn so much. And read it out loud. It's even better than reading it quietly. I'm going to read to you from an earlier speech, God's Hope for America. Now this speech, God's Hope for America, was a two-part speech. It was given on two different days, October 20th and October 21st of 1973. Father was doing a tour, like I said, speaking in different cities. And he had two nights. So people would come for one night, and then they would have to come the next night to the finish. Finish it. And this is the speech he gave called, the first speech was called God's Hope for Man, and then the next speech given the next night was God's Hope for America. And they were October 20th and 21st. We're just going to read one section from it. This is toward the end of the speech. Father has spent the whole first part of the speech passing over the entire history of God's providence, starting with Adam and then Noah and all the different central figures in the biblical history, up to Jesus and then the different missionaries and different activities of Christianity for 2,000 years. Finally, talking about the Pilgrim Fathers and how people came here risking their lives. We talked about this 2 weeks ago with Thanksgiving, right? Risking their lives to have religious freedom. And that they did everything in the name of God. And that God was the center of America in the beginning. Everyone who came here was religious, deeply religious. There were some prospectors, there were some very non-religious people that came, it's true. But many, many very religious, very poor people who were escaping from religious persecution came here. And throughout history, America has been a place where people who suffered from religious persecution could find some kind of a home. The Mormons, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, was founded in the 1800s in upstate New York, Elmira, New York, and that area, upstate New York. And then, because of persecution, they moved, I think, to Illinois, and then they were persecuted there, and they moved out to Utah. So America has persecuted religious people, too. And then the Seventh-day Adventists, and the Jehovah's Witnesses, and the Christian Scientists, and there are many, many religious groups. And then, of course, religions of the East have come in, you know, Buddhism and yoga, and Guru Maharishi Mahesh Yogi was in the 1960s, the Beatles liked him, and he became popular in America in the 70s. Everyone was meditating and yoga and that kind of thing. And now it's very common to do yoga and meditation. Everyone's doing it. So that's another thing we've added to our rich cultural heritage here in America. So America's a country that was founded on religious freedom and on God. And Father makes this point. Then he says, this is God's warning. It's the second to last section of the speech. In our time, all Christians should be world champions, destined to fulfill for God the role of the right-hand side thief. At Jesus' cross, crucifixion, there were two thieves crucified with Jesus. There was a thief on his right and a thief on his left. The thief on his left was mocking him, saying, "If you're the Son of God, get us down from here." You know, and he was mocking him like that. And Jesus was dying on the cross. And the right-hand side thief scolded this other thief and said, "We deserve to be here. But this man is sinless. He's done nothing wrong. So shut up." You know, he's basically telling the other thief to be quiet. And Jesus turned to him and said, "You will be in paradise with me on this day." Because he recognized Jesus. So even though he was being killed for stealing, which is a pretty harsh punishment, but we know that in the Middle East, even now, the Islamic faith, if you're caught stealing, the penalty is that your hand is cut off. So you don't steal anymore.
And you can see that a person who has their hand off.
And you can see the person who had his hand cut off was a thief. So it's very brutal. But the Jews were just as brutal 2,000 years ago. The Old Testament faith is very much like the modern Islamic faith, the fundamentalist Islamic faith. It's very serious. It's very black and white. There's right and wrong. And these are the punishments if you do something wrong. There's no forgiveness. Forgiveness is not part of it. So this poor man was being crucified for being a thief. And yet, even as he's dying, he's scolding this other guy for being unrighteous to Jesus. He's recognizing Jesus. He's trying to protect Jesus. So Jesus recognized his courage. And he says, those two thieves have spiritually have become Christianity and communism in the modern world. The communist world accusing God, saying there is no God, and mocking God. And we saw that in this election with many, many people who were angry at the Christian right, who felt there is no God, that the Christians are just hypocrites, and they were very immoral many times, right? Very immoral. They've done wrong things, and they're flaunting it. So we saw that kind of communist influence, that kind of Marxist, materialistic influence on this election. On the other side, we see Christians, who are also thieves, right? That means they have sin. That means they're not perfect. But they are recognizing God. They're saying God exists, and we have to be humble to God. Otherwise, there's no hope for us to change. So these are the two thieves that Father said, spiritually, they became Christianity and communism. Okay? So in this, now he's saying, Christianity is destined to fulfill for God the role of the right-hand side thief. Christians must rise and be willing to struggle for the salvation of the world. But Christians today, this is 1973, so this is what, 40 years ago? 43 years ago. And the words are just as true today, it's actually more true today than they were 40 years ago. But Christians today are too busy perfecting their separate denominations and church interests. We must unite with the coming of the Lord. The end of the world signifies that the time of the arrival of the Lord of the second advent is near. Jesus had to come back because he could not fulfill on the cross everything he wanted to do. So he prophesied the second coming of Christ. And we know now that that was Reverend Moon. Reverend Moon was the second coming of Christ. He brought the truth to liberate mankind. Please study the divine principle and these father's speeches and ask yourself if what I'm saying is true. That's the only way you could find out, is if God tells you. So please, please pray about it and study what he's taught. So he's talking about the father's talking about the second coming of Christ in the third person. He says, he must have a base somewhere, some foundation prepared upon which he can begin to fulfill his mission. America is meant to be that base. But America is deeply troubled. When I first came to America, Father says, I went to New York, and we are part of the New York community here in Connecticut. We all know Fifth Avenue. I went to New York and stood on Fifth Avenue during rush hour. Suddenly, tears began pouring down my face. I looked at the wonder of the Empire State Building, and the magnificence of the new Trade Center, which since then was knocked down by terrorists, right, in 2001, 28 years later. The tallest buildings in the world. But I asked myself, does God dwell in those buildings? New York is becoming more and more a city without God. It is a city of crime. Such a beautiful city is now crumbling. I can see so much immorality and so many signs of godlessness in that city. It was shocking to my eyes as I stood watching during that rush hour. I could see so many things at once that are all intolerable in the sight of God. I asked God, is this the purpose for which you blessed America? I know God wants to see his spirit prevail in those great buildings. In those beautiful automobiles, he wants to see young people bubbling with enthusiasm for God and the love of others. It doesn't take the Empire State Building to glorify God. It doesn't take, and he says, a 1973 automobile to glorify God. We could change that to a 2017 automobile to glorify God. Even if you only have a rock as your altar, when you pour out your hope and your tears upon it, for the service of God, God is with you. I can really see that God is leaving the great city of New York. New York is instead becoming the city of evil. America has been known as the melting pot, where people of all colors, creeds, and nationalities are melted into one new breed. In order to melt anything, heat is required. Do you know who provided the heat for America? God was that heat. Without God, you could never have melted your people together. America could only achieve true brotherhood through the Christian spirit. But when you begin to lose that foundation, America's moral fiber will deteriorate. Today, there are many signs of the decline of America. What about the American young people? What about your drug problems and your juvenile crime problems? What about the breakdown of your families? I hear that 3 out of every 4 marriages in America end in divorce. The California state government is issuing more divorce certificates than marriage licenses. What about racial problems? It's still real, right? Even with the whole election, we saw it. What about racial problems and the threat of communism? And what about the economic crises? Why are all these problems occurring? These are signs that God is leaving America. I can read the sign, which says, God is leaving America now. If this trend continues, in a very short time, God will be with you no longer. God is leaving America's homes. God is leaving your society. God is leaving your schools. God is leaving your churches. God is leaving America. There are many signs of atheism in this once God-centered nation. There have been many laws enacted, as we know, like the gay marriage laws, same-sex marriage laws. There have been many laws enacted that only a godless society could accept. There was a time when prayer was America's daily diet. Today you hear prayers in American schools no longer. And then Father goes on to talk about a new spiritual revolution that's needed and the quality of faith that's needed. And that's the end of that speech. I recommend that you read the speech if you want to hear more about what Father says there. But I've decided, I'm going to put more and more of my time and energy into not only the website, Self-Evident Nation, but into the work it takes to promote the idea that I had actually 13 years ago when we first came to Bridgeport. I was struck by an idea, a revelation. I saw that this problem was continuing in America, and that Americans were losing God, especially in the schools. I'm a school teacher, and in no school in America is prayer allowed, and no public school teacher is allowed to talk about God, even though the whole universe was created by God. But we can't talk about God in schools. So what kind of a school does that create? It creates a school where, yes, religious freedom is somehow protected, but actually, where atheism, or the belief that there is no God, is actually protected most, and where it's promoted, actually. The idea, the schools, inadvertently, I'm sure, they don't intend to, or some people may, but the schools are actually, because what you give your kids, when your kids go to school, and they see that none of the teachers, none of the administrators are talking about God, that you're not allowed to talk about God, the teachers feel scared to talk about God, they begin to think that if they feel they believe in God, they feel like in a minority. There's no support for their belief in school. There can't be any signs of Christmas, there can't be any signs of religion. Everything's being taken out of the schools. So their personal life of faith as Christians or Jews or Muslims or Buddhists or whatever is not affirmed in the schools. But atheism is affirmed in the schools. So whether they realize it or not, the schools are sending a very clear message. We don't believe in God. And if you believe in God, you are a dinosaur. You're a relic. Look at modern science. It very clearly proves that there is no God. But we know that that's not true. That there are many gaps in the scientific theories that could only be solved by the influence of an outside force coming into this closed system. And we've talked about that in other lectures and sermons. The idea that the greatest scientist of all is God. How can an explosion, a big bang of energy, suddenly coalesce into different forms of matter, very complex molecules, solar systems and planets and orbiting and all of these laws. Where do they come from? Laws. What's a law? Can you measure a law? Can you see a law? You can see the result of the law of gravity, but can you actually touch the law of gravity? Does it exist? It exists. Wait a minute. But you can't see it, you can't touch it, you can't smell it, you can't taste it, you can't measure it. You can measure the effect it has on the bodies that are falling, mass pulling against mass. But where do these laws come from? They're invisible. They're not. What are laws made out of? Mm-hmm. Are laws made out of energy? You know, Marxism would say everything is made out of matter and energy. Well, then are laws made out of energy? What are laws made out of? Laws are controlling matter, and yet we can't touch them, see them, taste them. We can't, they don't exist in a physical sense. It's because laws are actually God's hand controlling the universe to move it in the direction that he wants to create it.
Well, even in science, a lot tends to get destroyed. Like, that's another, like, law or something that, what is it?
Entropy. The law of entropy,
yeah,
is that all energy tends to the greatest dissolution, the greatest widespread, being as widespread as possible, not being coalesced in a single place. But that's violated by every creation, which coalesces matter into an energy into one place. That's why the atomic bomb can work, especially hydrogen bomb. You split a hydrogen atom, and the bonding energy is so great in a hydrogen atom that when the two hydrogen atoms split and become actually join together and become one helium atom, all the bonding energy of this two, which is greater than the helium atom, is released, and that's the power of hydrogen bomb. So all this energy is staying in one place, holding this thing together. That's a violation of the law of entropy. Who's doing that? So when you understand science deep enough, you actually begin to see God everywhere. And yet we're not allowed to talk about that in schools. And so our kids are growing up thinking that God is marginalized. People who believe in God are on the margins of society. And that was the big shock in this election. The very arrogant, proud people who thought that Trump was, and the people who supported Trump especially, they thought the red states are basically these hicks, people who believe in God and are old-fashioned in their thinking and are closed-minded, narrow-minded bigots, homophobes, and all these people that they thought they were going to get defeated. They thought that they would lose. But actually, America still wants God. And that's, I think, the key thing that decided this election is who wants God to be the center and who does not want God to be the center. And it was very close, very close. And this is why I dedicate myself to this work. What I want to do, and I've talked about this before with my children, and I've talked about this with you, but what I'm going to be doing is, in Self-Evident Nation, is I want to bring the Declaration of Independence into the Constitution as its vision statement. The Constitution is a secular document. The Founding Fathers believed that a secular government would be the best guarantee of religious freedom. That the government should have no religion. Because in Europe, every state actually has its own religion. The Lutheran Church is the state religion of Sweden, of Denmark, I think, of Norway. The Anglican Church, of course, the Church of England is the National Church of England. The Presbyterian Church is the National Church of Scotland. You know, the Catholic Church, of course, is the National Church of Italy and Spain and Portugal. So you have national churches. You have the government is officially Catholic or officially Lutheran.
They're pretty secular.
And they're very secular. The churches have been marginalized. But the Founding Fathers felt that it would be safer to have a secular government. So they built the Constitution as a secular thing. But they all believed in God. George Washington, when he was being sworn in, said, "Where's the Bible? There's no Bible. I bring a Bible. I'm not going to swear in without a Bible." And he had a Bible brought, and he put his hand on the Bible and swore in with his hand on the Bible. And from that point on, all presidents have been sworn in with their hand on a Bible. But that was not part of the original Founding Fathers, idea. They wanted a secular government. But George Washington knew, because he had prayed desperately at Valley Forge. He had prayed desperately for God's guidance, because his army was almost destroyed, starving to death in the winter, and there was almost no hope. They were being beaten by the British. And the American experiment was almost dead on arrival, you know, dead at birth. But George Washington prayed, and he got inspirations from God how to fight, and he won. And he knew that God was behind the founding of America. It's not a coincidence that we have "In God We Trust" on our money. And even in schools where the most secular forms are there, you still see the desire of people to try to include God in the Pledge of Allegiance. You know, "I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all." They're not requiring anyone to say it, and many students don't say it. I see, you know, many students don't say it, but some students do, and some people who are very patriotic stand up very proudly and they say it. So it's a freedom that we have, but it's there. And we say things like, when there's been a tragedy and someone's lost their life or something, our thoughts and prayers go out to that family. We say things like that, right? And we often hear "thank God" when something good happened. So you hear these expressions that are part of our culture, cultural identity. And they're in the schools too. So there is a struggle. Why? Why is there the struggle? This is really the last thing we talk about before we close. America wants to protect freedom of religion. In the First Amendment, which was part of the Bill of Rights, there were 10 amendments that were tacked on before the Constitution was even ratified. They realized there were some things missing. And so they put on 10 points they felt had to be added on. Those 10 amendments became known as the Bill of Rights. The first of these 10 amendments is the one that guarantees the freedoms. It says that Congress, well, this is just a part for freedom of religion. "Congress shall make no law prohibit or regarding the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof." Congress shall make no law establishing a religion, regarding the establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Meaning the government has no right to stop people from worshiping the way they want. That's the second part. And nor will it establish its own religion like England did or other states did. So the government will not make any law about religion or prohibiting religion. So religion is it's called the separation of church and state. So the schools, which receive funds from taxes, are considered to be under that idea of government. The idea of Congress being that, as federal government originally, was transmuted to the states. And so state governments can't make any law that violates freedom of religion. And then the local governments also are considered to be under that, because they receive federal money in the schools and state money in the schools. So the schools feel like we cannot, if the teacher speaks about his own faith, his own religion, because he's a representative of the state, because he's being paid by the state or paid by the city, then it's almost like the state is saying, this is the true religion. You have to follow this religion. So they say that's why teachers cannot speak about their religion. So it makes sense. So that means that this is going on. So for a very good reason, they're trying to protect freedom of religion. But the result, as we've seen, is the removal of religion and removal of God and removal of faith from the schools. And this is not a good thing. It's not helping our schools. The problem lies in the difference between religion and God. Faith in God and religion are not necessarily the same thing. We have to make a decision as a nation. Do we believe in God or not? Now, it may seem insane to God that the people He created are going to make a vote to decide whether they think He exists or not. Thank you very much, you know. Oh, yeah, I'm very curious. Do you think I exist? Oh, yeah, okay, I'm waiting. I mean, it's insane that God has to sit there and watch as America makes a decision. We believe that God exists. We don't believe that God exists. What idiots, right? What fools. But God, give us free will. And our decision is very important. What we decide is very important. So it's very important, actually, that we make this decision. Does God exist or not? Now, as an individual, you're still protected by the First Amendment. But as a nation, we have to decide, do we believe that God exists or not? You can't have it both ways. Either God exists or he doesn't. You can't say, we don't want to make a decision. We're a secular nation. No, it doesn't work that way. Sorry. The Old Testament is full of examples of that. I have called my people before my face. Right? He's called his people, God says. This nation was called by God. So God's not going to permit, and neither will Satan. God is not going to permit this nation to sit on a fence. It has to decide. Now, does that mean that there will no longer be freedom of religion? No. Just because the nation says, we as a nation believe in God, doesn't mean that you as a citizen are not don't have freedom how you want to worship God or if you want to worship God. That is still guaranteed by the Constitution. So how do we get that nice balance between a nation believing in God and respecting freedom of religion? How do we get that balance? They seem like opposites. The key, the secret, is in the Declaration of Independence. If we try to create a constitutional amendment ourselves at this time, it would never pass. We could never write the words accurately enough. Someone would always want to change the words. There's nothing you can do about that. But there is a document that we all love and respect, the Declaration of Independence, which talks about God and talks about a creator actually founding America. And it's older than the Constitution. And it is the base of the Constitution. It's like when a baby is born, 9 months earlier, there was conception, right? The sperm and egg met. The conception of America is the Declaration of Independence. The birth is the Constitution. So they're related, obviously. And we have to connect them again. The Declaration of Independence has been marginalized. We have to bring it in again as the preamble to the Constitution, as its vision and mission statement. Look at the words of the Declaration of Independence. We hold these truths to be self-evident. What does that mean? That these truths are self-evident. What does that mean? What is it, something that's evident? Obvious. So self-evident means it's obvious in itself. It doesn't need any proof. We don't need to support this idea. We don't need to defend this idea. These ideas, this truth is self-evident. It's obvious. It's obvious, like the sun is in front of my face. You could talk philosophy all you want. Is the sun really there? Yeah, okay, you go and have that conversation with someone else, but not with me, because the sun is there. We can discuss relativity and reality and matter and energy and what is really there, and we can have philosophical discussions, but it shouldn't get in the way of our making decisions. The sun is there. It's hot. Okay, so making decisions based on that reality is wise. Ignoring that reality to have an argument about whether the sun is there is stupid. So the Founding Fathers said, we hold these truths to be self-evident. Here they are. That all men, and we can include women, is the biblical version of men, meaning man and woman, but we can change it to men and women, it doesn't matter, we can understand it in that term. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Created equal. This is self-evident truths. Self-evident truths. They don't need proof. They're so obvious, they don't need proof. The Founding Fathers felt that God's creation of us was self-evident. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. Going on, that they are endowed by their creator, not satisfied to say they're created, that they're endowed, being given, endowed by their creator, with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So the most famous line is that, I think, from the Declaration of Independence, that we are endowed by our Creator with unalienable rights, that among these rights are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The idea of life is a right. We have a right to live. We have a right to pursue a livelihood, to work, to make money, to support our family and ourselves. So the life, liberty, freedom was a right that they felt came from God. Life and liberty, life and freedom, are God-given rights. So anyone who's worried that bringing in the Declaration of Independence will take away the freedom of religion or take away people's rights is not reading it carefully enough. Because it says very clearly that their vision, the Declaration of Independence vision of God, is a God who gives you life and gives you the right to liberty, freedom, and the pursuit of happiness. You should be able to follow what you think will make you happy, as long as it doesn't make someone else unhappy. And there are laws to protect each other from that. Let's read the whole thing again. We hold these truths to be self-evident, obvious, that all men are created equal, that they're given the same beginning point by God, which may be not true. I mean, everyone is born in different circumstances, some rich, some poor, different circumstances. Some good families, some bad families. So there's definitely circumstances that we're born into that are not equal. But the idea is that God's heart toward every child of His is the same. That everyone should have the same starting point. That it should be fair. So that's amazing. That's an amazing democratic sentiment that the Declaration of Independence has. And so it is totally honorable and worthy of being the law of our land, the constitution of our land. That there should be a constitutional amendment to bring in the Declaration of Independence as the preamble, as the vision statement of America. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights. You can't take them away. You cannot remove these rights. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We need those words to have constitutional authority, not just historical authority. Right now, they're a historical document, but they don't have any constitutional authority. By bringing them in with an amendment, by bringing them into the Constitution with an amendment, it gives the Declaration of Independence constitutional authority. And this will actually balance the First Amendment. The First Amendment is still there, guaranteeing freedom of religion and separation of church and state. But now we have the Declaration of Independence saying, we hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are created equal, endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. So that means our rights come from God. We're created by God. God exists. It's a way on a national level of us saying, we believe that God exists and our rights come from God. Our life comes from God. Our liberty comes from God. And the right to not believe in God comes from God. God's pretty confident in Himself. I give you the right to not believe in me. I exist. I think I exist. I'm here. But if you don't want to believe in me, that's your choice. That's freedom. God gives that freedom. That's the amazing thing about our God. And we should celebrate that God. Let's give God a hand. Yes, God. Let's sing Our God is an Awesome God. Ready? Here we go. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. One more time. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. One more time. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Woo! So, our God is an awesome God. And the Declaration of Independence celebrates that God and that our rights come from God. And it guarantees the freedoms that we have in America. And that's that can bring unity to this country, this divided country, this country split like it is. And it can give power back to people who believe in God to speak about God, maybe in the classrooms, maybe in schools, without mentioning religion or faith or tenets of faith or dogmas or any kind of doctrines, but just to say, let's explore the possibility of an outside entity that has put something into this system in science. Or maybe we can talk about the struggle of America. And in history classes, we can talk about the struggle, religion and the role of religion more openly. It'll give us a little more freedom. We can pray in the morning. We can read the Declaration of Independence in the morning. That's the passage we just did. That could be our morning prayer. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they're endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these rights are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Wow, what a great way to start the day at school. Right? That's what we can open up. So this is the movement I want to start and I want to devote time to now. I feel that that's where God is pushing me to go. It's not enough that we just take care of spiritual life. We also have to take care of the political and economic life of our country. And that political life is centered on what we believe, what our Constitution say. That's the core. The Constitution is the core of what we believe and what we do as a nation. And right now it's not meeting our needs. It's pushing religion out of the way. It's pushing God out of our society. And it seems like there's no way to solve it, because the First Amendment guarantees separation of church and state. But if we bring the Declaration of Independence in, that solves the problem. And it lets us have a good balance between recognizing God's existence and guaranteeing separation of church and state. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, you are an awesome God. And you're so beautiful and you're so confident that, you can guarantee freedom to your children. And even if we don't believe in you, like the prodigal son that ran away from home and took his money that he would be given an inheritance and squandered it, lost everything in gambling and women and song and dance and partying, basically. And he came back home poor and penniless, like a beggar, asking just for a job. He was so poor, he was working in somebody's pig farm in another town. And he said, it's better for me to work for my father than to do this. And so he basically crawled back home. And his father saw him coming and said, kill the fatted calf. Let's have a party. My son who is dead is alive again. And he welcomed him as his son. And the older son, who's been faithful and true, was angry because that you had welcomed your prodigal son home. That is your heart. You're not a persecutor of people. There are religions that persecute people who don't believe the way that they do. But Christianity is not one of those religions, and in its truest form. And the Declaration of Independence is, in some ways, the purest form of Christianity. And it recognizes the freedoms that you have given us to find our own way to you. And I ask your blessing, Father, that you can bless my ministry, not just here in home church, but also in building a national movement, a worldwide national movement, to bring the Declaration of Independence back into the Constitution through an amendment. And I ask your blessing that this can pick up steam and momentum, and that we can see this come to pass as an amendment to the U.S. Constitution, and that we can see America rise again as a great religious nation, a nation of faith, a nation of love. Thank you so much for this day. I ask your blessing. We offer this report to you in the name of Raman and Tamiko Montanaro, blessed Central Family. Chukpok Jungshim Kajang, Raman Gwa Tamiko Montanaro, Irumaro, Pogo Dirimida, Aju.
Amen. Amen.